Hey, who told you to come out? Come here. Come here, girl. Good girl. Come here. Good girl. Good girl. What's she doing? Good girl. Good girl. Very good. Bye.
Due south.
Unfortunately, that cloud seems not to be moving. That white cloud, you can tell I'm standing still. That white cloud is as still as a mountain. Look at this lightning. Get over here. Hey. Clown man. Look over here. Get over here. Come here. I relay the events that unfolded on that day, the 27th of July, 2022. In the morning, a coworker of mine appears 2 hours late, unexpectedly after he was out Monday and Tuesday, due to his uncle having been in a critical state of unhealth since the week before. He told me that week that his uncle, age 35, had passed out and was brought into the emergency room. The problem? He didn't eat. He was a severely underweight Asian fellow, and for some reason he almost never ate. When my coworker shows up, I ask about his uncle's condition. He tells me that they decided to let him go. He was in a coma and had suffered some nerve or brain damage from malnutrition and would have otherwise been kept alive as a bedridden vegetable. After working for 1 or 2 hours, he vanishes without telling anybody. Around 5 in the afternoon, I come home from work to find my parents and brother out in the backyard. My father and brother are calling out for one of our dogs, Blynn. I join the search, calling out her name, but after a short time, my father finds her, lying in a bed of red flowers, attached to the back of the house. Taking in the scene from afar, I cry out to him to pick her up, but all he can say is, "She's dead." I get frustrated with my mom for suggesting we bury her right away. My father and I talk, trying to figure out what happened. My parents say she was sick from a jaw infection and perhaps wasn't able to eat. My father notices a shovel that had been standing upright, fallen over towards her body, just a few inches away. Perhaps it fell on her, we wonder. I go to her body and petted her a few times before covering her with a shirt of mine and one of my brother's. I retreat into my RV and put on Lash's latest YouTube talk, "Love is the Serene Ocean That Rocks Your Heart." A month ago, I posted a riddle in the Treehouse Forum thread about the unassigned shift. It went, "What does it mean to have an empty heart?" The riddle falls on deaf ears, and in one instance, a woman of my acquaintance emotionally misinterprets the meaning behind it. When I hear Lash reveal his own answer to the task, define love, that he proposes while having breakfast with a couple of friends, emptiness, I get a strong ping of joy and leap out of the RV to run into the house, then in the backyard where my parents were still working. Some time later, my father pokes his head into my RV to try to announce something with great difficulty. "You should go see the shed," he says. There's something in there for you." "What now?" I groan. I pressure him to spit it out. Finally, he admits, while looking for a rake in the shed just now, he accidentally stepped on a bat and wanted me to check on it. I get angry with him and demand he come with me, which he does after finishing raking beneath the maple to plant shade grass seed. I find the bat on the ground with him, with a broken left wing. His left hand or claws were completely gone, with just a bloody stump at the end. I pick him up despite his protest. He bites me a few times on my left fingers, but it neither hurts nor does he pierce the skin. Not knowing what to do, I set him on a couch in the backyard and retreat to the RV with the rest of my dogs. Later, he climbs off the couch and disappears without a trace. When it gets dark, I'm standing outside by the maple talking with my dad, who has thrown some grass seed and hewn a fence around it. We both notice the white fur of one of our animals in the street.
At first I thought it was Whitey, our other dog, so I call out her name, but Whitey was safe in the RV. It was our black, gray, and white cat, Minnie. Right at that moment, a loud, rusty, off-white Ford kind of truck turns the corner onto our street and accelerates with a rumble. I call out for my cat and run towards the street. The driver, who we later discover was a fat Mexican, accelerates even louder, as if to strike the cat, who starts running away in the same direction. I make it to the street just as he passes and scream into his window, "What the fuck is wrong with you?" He swerves slightly as to not hit me and misses the cat as well. I stay standing in the middle of the road in front of my house, in part baffled, though largely furious. Minutes later, while I'm still standing there, the same rusty, loud white Ford comes back. Hoodlums are fond of parking by the lake nearby. I stare down the car as it drives towards, but around me. The next day, which designates the first day of this year's Bhairavi shift, I wake up from a nap after work and dig the hole just north of a large ash tree, nearby where Blinn's body was, fittingly with the same suspicious shovel we found nearby. I called my father to attend the impromptu ceremony. I go to her body, kneel beside it, stroke her soft fur, and wail loudly. After some time, crying and moaning, I pick up her corpse and wail even louder. Despite my father's insistence to be quiet, as the neighbors would hear, I tell him I don't care. I stood holding her for a while. Then I command my dad to light the bonfire, which goes up quickly and with fierce strength. I wasn't able to tell if her neck or spine had been broken by a falling shovel. Her death remains a mystery to me, except that she died alone, quietly beside the red flowers. Could have been a west wind, though. Gusts have been particularly strong here lately. These events are washing over me. I am not sad, although I have felt the guilt of neglect. I was able to process, and I mean physically, verbally, bodily, process the grief in the elegant manner of a child's tantrum. To recap, I find out my co-worker's 35-year-old uncle was put down, 1. 2. We discover my dead dog in the garden laying beside red flowers. 3. JLL's love talk resonates with a riddle of the empty heart I posed at the beginning of the shift. 4. My dad steps on a bat and breaks his left wing. The bat later disappears. 5. A Mexican in a rusty Ford almost drives over my cat. All of these occurred within a 13-hour period, the completion day of that enigmatic shift. My intention was to relay these omens in the mood of dispassion, indifference. If I have successfully transmitted that sublime mood, then I have accomplished my purpose.
Do you hear her?